Good morning. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up, and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. I have found a friend in Jesus, he's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Only in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Well, good morning. It is good to see everybody here. I don't know about you, but I am excited to be here and have the opportunity to worship God together. So as we are gathered, we are going to do just that. If you haven't, make sure you do have your communion packets, because we'll be using those shortly. So let's go ahead and we'll sing this next song. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all of thy strength. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all of thy mind. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart. Hear, O Israel.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beautiful opportunity that you've given us today to meet in person and to worship you and study your word, Lord. We're So thankful for the cooler weather that you've sent us this morning, along with the rain, Lord. Our land was needing it, and of course you provided as you always do. Lord, we ask that you be with all of our number who are sick and hurting right now, Lord, and especially right now as we're going through the pandemic and lots of families are dealing with this COVID disease. Lord, we pray that you heal them and be with the doctors as they treat them, give them wisdom on how best to treat this illness, and the researchers that are helping to find a vaccine, the wisdom that you have given us through the years. Lord, we ask that you open their minds and allow them to figure out what to do to take care of this pandemic, Lord. Lord, we have a large portion of our nation right now is hurting. They feel disenfranchised. And Lord, prick our hearts to be lights for you, to find those people who are hurting and to help them. Let them know that God loves them, that we love them, and that we stand beside them in helping to fight their issues that they have, Lord. We also pray for our law enforcement officers right now, Lord. We know a large portion of them do a fantastic job in keeping us safe, Lord. So please help us to encourage them through this time, Lord, to help them, to let them know that we care about them and we're thankful for the service that they provide, as we know that evil still prevails in this world, Lord. Father, as we continue in this service, help us to block out all those things in this world that are bothering us right now, and to focus on the meaning of us being here, and that's the many blessings and the ultimate sacrifice that you gave us in sending your Son. And in his name we pray. Amen.
We don't usually stand for the song before communion. However, this is one that, if you don't mind, I would like us to stand to sing this song.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, his solid mound, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What height of love, what depth of peace, when fear was still,
all the precious love. at this time, we come to the most meaningful part of our worship to you, Lord. We see that John quoted Jesus in John 6:51. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Let's pray. Almighty God, we're so very grateful to you because although we were unworthy, you sent a living sacrifice that will completely reconcile us to you. We're so very grateful for this, O God. And not only to us did you give this, you gave it to the entire world. At this time, we think about Jesus, who was willing to come and give his life, his body, for us. We pray that we will take of it in a manner be well pleasing to you, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Once again, O Lord, we come before you, thinking about your blood, your precious blood that flowed to wash away our sins. The Hebrew writer recorded, "How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God? For this reason, Christ is the mediator of the new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. Now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant." Almighty God, we're so very grateful for your Son, Jesus, who died and shed his blood for us, that our sins can be completely washed away. And Lord, we know that we continue to fall short each and every day, but we're so thankful that your blood continues to wash us and to make us clean and pure before you. We pray, O God, that we will never lose sight of this and will always strive with all of our heart to serve you and to submit ourselves to you. We thank you, O Lord, for this precious blood. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We recognize, God, that your blessings continue to be showered down upon us. You have been so generous to us and given us so much. We just want to thank everyone who have continued to give of their means to support the work at Waterview and for the kingdom. And you can go to waterview.org and continue to give online. Or you can prepare a check and put it in one of the boxes in the foyer. Or you can mail your check to Waterview. I recall that in 1 Thessalonians 5:17 it says, "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for it's God's will for you in Christ Jesus." I pray, O God, that we will continue to remember that all of our resources, all of our blessings flow forth from you. In times of good, in times of need, they still continually flow. And we pray, O God, that we will give of our means, as the early Christians did, to support those who are in need and to support this work in our many mission efforts throughout the world. We ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
If you would, let's be standing for this song as well.
How sweet, how heavenly is the sight when those that love the Lord in one another's peace delight and so fulfill the word. When he can feel his brother's sight and with him there afar in song.
Four men in the hospital waiting to hear news. Their wife is in the delivery room. And suddenly a nurse rushes out to the first of these men and says, "Congratulations, you're the father of twins." He says, "How ironic. I work for the Minnesota Twins." About that time, another nurse rushes out and says to the next fellow, "Congratulations, you're the father of triplets." And he says, "Well, that's even more ironic. I work for the 3M company." About that time, a nurse rushes out and says to the next fellow, you're the father of quadruplets." And the man says, "Man, this is getting strange because I work for Four Seasons Hotel." And about that time, the fourth gentleman, he starts banging his head against the wall and holding his head. And they all say, "Well, sir, what's wrong with you?" And he said, "You won't believe this, but I work for 7-Up. That story is an old story. It has nothing to do with our lesson today. But I'll tell you the reason I told it. The name of our lesson today is 7-Up Christianity. And I'll explain what I mean by that in just a few moments. In the meantime, I hope you have a Bible. Take it and turn with me to Romans, the 15th chapter. You may remember last week I said something about how important Romans 14 and 15 really are, and how they would help us in times like these. And yet, it was a little warm in here, if you recall, last week, and I was trying to speed up just as much as I can or could. So I kind of glazed over some passages I wanted to look at last week. So I thought, I'll come back to that this week. So that's why we're going to be in Romans chapter 15. I mentioned a story last week. I want to follow up on that and add just something a little to it. I mentioned that Candy and I have been watching the television series Alone by the History Channel. And of course, the premise, if you missed this last week, the premise is they take 10 individuals, survivalists, and they put them in the wilderness. And the competition is who can stay out there the longest and survive. And the premise is you've got to do this alone. And so I told you we were watching that show. We finished up season three this past week, and we actually watched one episode in season four. And remember, I said this show illustrates how it's difficult when we're separated from each other. It's difficult when we're alone. And it reminds us how we need each other. And so we started watching season four, and there's a plot twist. The plot twist is now they have introduced, instead of 10 individuals, they've introduced 7 couples or 7 pairs of people. And the whole premise now, the way this season is beginning, is you start out alone, separated from your other person, and one of them has the responsibility to go and find the other one in the couple, and then together they have to survive. And I just thought to myself, how appropriate. Because isn't that kind of what we need to be doing with each other? How appropriate, because when we realize how dire of a situation it is for us to be alone, for us to be separated from one another, knowing that we need each other, how appropriate then is it for us to understand the need to find someone who is out there, who's hurting, who's struggling, and for us to find them, and for us together to make it through difficult times. That essentially is what Romans chapter 14 and chapter 15, I think, is really all about. It allows us to team up. It allows us to encourage each other, to be there for each other. It allows us to make sure that we're mindful that there are people in this world, that there are people in our body, in the church here right now at Waterview, and they're struggling, they're hurting. It could be emotionally, it could be physically. Yes, it could be spiritually, that there are those who are hurting and they're suffering, and right now they feel alone. They feel alone. Some of you may feel that way. Even though you're here in this midst, you may actually feel alone, and you may feel like you need a connection with someone. And so that's why God gives us the church. That's what the church is really all about. It is a place to find each other. It is a place to find family. It is a place to find support. And so that brings us back to Romans chapter 15. I hope you've already turned there. And so what we basically find in Romans chapter 15, you'll find seven up principles. So therefore the name of the lesson, seven up Christianity. You'll find seven up principles in Romans chapter 15. In each of those first seven verses, there is an up principle there. And here's what the up principle is about. It's about how there are some in the church who realize they have a responsibility to bear with or to work with, to be there for those who are weaker than they are. If that sounds like Romans chapter 14, that's what Romans chapter 14 is essentially about. If I'll give you just a really brief recap of Romans 14, before we jump into Romans 15, what it's really about is that Paul is writing to Christians at the church at Rome, and he's really talking about two different kinds of Christians. There are strong Christians, and there are weaker Christians. Strong and weak. Now, the issues in those days were things like eating meats or observing special days. And today, while the issues may have changed, one thing remains the same. And that is, there will still be stronger Christians in the church, and there will be weaker Christians in the church. And so what Paul's teaching really is all about here, what he said to them in those days, 2,000 years ago, it applies today. And that is, we are taught to be concerned about those in the church who are struggling, those in the church who are weak. And if there was ever a time, if there was ever a need for Christians to practice Romans chapter 14 and Romans chapter 15 Christianity, the time is now. We really need to do this. And so Paul teaches us, we've got this responsibility to the weak, and he offers us these seven up principles. I'm going to go fast, so be willing and ready to keep up. I hope you're right there in Romans chapter 15 and verse 1. Let's start with up principle number one. The first up principle is pick up. Look at verse 1, and Paul says, "We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves." I want you to notice the word bear in the translation that I read from. Notice the word bear. Paul says, "We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak." Some might say that this means that we ought to put up with the weak. In other words, that we should just tolerate them. But that's not what this is meaning. It doesn't mean we ought just to tolerate the weak. It means instead of putting up with them, we ought to pick them up. We ought to pick them up. In other words, we don't just tolerate them. We try to help them. And notice he says we have this obligation. It's not an option. It's not like your, well, what used to be the buffets we could go through. We'll probably never do that again, right? But you don't have the option to do this, to take it or not. Paul says you've got this obligation. If you're strong, you have the obligation to pick up the weak. So he tells us how to do that as he moves forward. First principle, pick up. Second principle, build up. He says in verse 2, let each of us please his neighbor for his good. Here it is, to build him up. The key to remembering how to do this and why we should do this is actually found in the last four words of verse number 1, where it says, not to please ourselves. I want to remind you that Christianity is not a religion for pleasing self. Jesus himself said, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. And what Paul is really saying here in Romans chapter 15 is what he had said in Philippians chapter 2, a passage that we're all so familiar with in verses 3 and 4, where he says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for your own interest, but also for the interest of others. And so Christianity is a religion. It is something that we practice where we don't please self first. We look out for others. And in this context, Paul says you've got to be looking out for the weak among you. To build up means we promote Christian relationships, the kind of relationships that will help other people grow. The phrase build up is a construction term. When we build up others, we are allowing God to use us to help construct other Christians. And if that sounds like what you sometimes hear preachers talk about, discipling people, that's really what it is. We disciple those around us. We're constructing them. We're building them up. But I want to remind you that something we see very often is really quite the opposite of this. Contrast this with what we often see Christians doing. Instead of building each other up, what we normally see, what we sometimes see, is this concept of blasting each other, tearing them down. Christians fussing and fighting with their fellow Christian. Now, one other quick thing before I move on to number 3 here. Building up our weak brother, who in this case, according to Romans chapter 14, is the one who is overly strict about these matters, it doesn't mean that the church is to be governed by the whims of the weak. Instead, a genuine concern for the weak means that we pick them up and we build them up, and the idea is we try to lead them into a fuller and a better understanding of God's will for their life. That is how we pick up and then we build up. Principle number 3, look up. Look at verse number 3. In verse 3, Paul refers to an Old Testament prophecy of Christ. You'll read this in Psalm chapter 69 and verse 9. And the principle here is what we've seen at the end of verse 1. He reminds us that Christ did not please himself. Verse 3 says, for Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. That's a messianic prophecy there in Psalm 69 and verse 9. So in our concern for the weak, if we're going to respond to them the way we should respond to them, we have to look up to Jesus. We have to look up to the cross. We have to understand this supreme example of Christ is there for us because he allowed the reproaches of the weak to fall on him. Why? Because he did not please himself. No matter what the issue, we'll always be better when we look up to the cross and we consider, what would Jesus do? Number 4, grow up. It's there in verse 4. Look what it says. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. How many times have you heard a preacher quote Romans 15 and verse 4, and then he went on to say, now this is talking about the Old Testament and how the Old Testament was written for our learning. And so, sure, this is a reminder that the Old Testament was written for our learning. But in the immediate context, it's a reminder that the only way we'll ever have a right attitude toward the weak, the only way a strong person can ever have a right attitude and respond to the weak the way they should, is for us to get in the Word. Truly, as Jesus said, search the Scriptures, because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness of me. Just like we said, when we look up at Jesus and then we look into His Scripture, we'll grow up and we'll think more like Him. We'll provide the sustenance, the spiritual sustenance to our soul that we'll actually need to be able to do what is right when a strong Christian is helping a weaker Christian. The only way to grow up is to study up. And as 1 Peter 2 and verse 2 says, as newborn babes desire the pure milk or the sincere milk of the Word that you may grow. That's what allows us to grow up. It's the Word. The only way we'll ever respond in a right way to people who need us is for us to be people of the Word. So let's rehearse. Pick up, build up, look up, grow up. Principle number 5, think up. Think up. There in verse 5, may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with each other in accord with Jesus Christ. Now, what's that all about? Just as we need to look up to Jesus, verse 5 reminds us that we need to think up to the way that God thinks. When we think like God thinks, we'll be reminded of how He endures with us. See, that's what God does. What God is saying, what Paul is saying for strong people to do, is to endure, to bear with, to pick up, to spend time with the weak. That's exactly how God looks at us, because in His eyes we are so weak. He's having to endure us. And so as we think about how God endures us and how He encourages us, then we'll have the right attitude when we think up to the way God thinks, so that we'll be able to deal with the problems that people have in our lives. I read something this past week. I think it's a good thing to remember. It was said by Eric Miller, "You do not have the emotional capital to be outraged by every outrageous thing. You are not infinite in stamina or empathy. You are not God." You've heard me say so many times that God is God and we are not. And so I think this quote fits into what I'm trying to say to you. I think sometimes we allow ourselves to get so bothered by everything that's going on in our world. And I'm not saying you shouldn't care. Don't misunderstand me. But sometimes we get so bothered by every little thing that's going on in our world that we use up all of our emotional capital on that. And then there are people all around us, right and left. Maybe we even live with some of them who need our emotional capital. And so I'm not saying don't be concerned about what's going on in the world, but I'm saying just start close to home and really pay attention to those who need you the most right now. It's a hard thing to do at times, but that's what God is calling us to do. Really what verse 5 is, it's a God rule. Now, you know about the golden rule, right? The golden rule, I'll paraphrase it by saying you're to treat others as you would like to be treated. The God rule here, as we think up to the way God thinks, is treat others the way God treats you. Treat others the way you want God to treat you. And when we do that, we're thinking up to the way God thinks about us. That's the kind of attitude we'll need, a strong to bear with the weak. Number 6, speak up. Look at verse 6. That together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. When we do what Paul says to do here in Romans 15, when we think of others, when we look up to Jesus, think about Jesus. When we look up to God, when we think like God, when we do those things, we won't have any problem being together with one voice. I love the concept here that we should be together because we're better together, remember? We should be together with one voice. As Christians, we need to come together. And the only way that we'll ever be able to do that is talk more about the things that unite us and spend maybe a little less time talking about the things that divide us. The perfect place for us to begin to do that is at a place like right now, what we're doing right now. For us to be together in worship as we praise, as Paul says, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Obviously, there is a time to disagree, and there is a way in which we should disagree. But I think sometimes Christians are too quick to jump into the public debating ring. It's almost like, you know, the wrestling ring, and we just want to get up in it, and we want to debate, we want to fuss, and we want to fight. And you know who the spectators are when Christians are up in that ring? You know who the spectators are? It's all those people out there in the world. All those people out there in the world who are not Christians. And they're looking at this debating ring, and they see Christians fussing and fighting and not speaking with one voice and not being unified the way that we ought to. And they say, yeah, I don't really have no interest in being like that, in wanting to be a part of a movement like that. I would suggest if we have to debate, if we have to disagree, let's try as much as possible to do that in private. And then let's take our unified voices, let's go back out in the streets and re-engage the lost and allow those who are seeing us as non-Christians to see something attractive. Nobody really likes to walk up on an argument. Nobody really likes it. And so let's try to speak with a unified voice and do some good. Number seven. After we pick up, after we build up, after we grow up, after we look up, after we think up, and after we speak up, number seven, we need to open up. Verse 7, Romans 15, is a perfect summation, I think, of Romans 14 and 15. We need to open our hearts to others. And in this case, we need to open our hearts to the weak. If my brother or my sister has come to the Lord has received them, the Lord has forgiven them, just the same way that He's received me, just the same way that He's forgiven me, and what I need to do is do what the Lord does. I need to open up. The key thought here is merciful acceptance of the flawed. You know who that describes? It describes your preacher. It describes your shepherds. It describes every member of this church. Because when God receives us, it's the merciful acceptance of the flawed. And everybody that comes to the Lord, that's what happens. There are strong, and there are those who are weak. In Romans 14 and verse 3, God welcomes the weak. In Romans 15 and verse 7, Christ welcomes the weak. And right here in this message, in this verse number 7, Paul says, you do the same thing. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you. And notice what the last little phrase there says. It says, for the glory of God. There is something that amazing that happens when people who differ come together. You can differ with someone, and yet you can come together, and you both can be one in Christ Jesus, and it can provide the greatest example in the world to those who are not Christians about what Christianity is all about. That's what Paul is saying here. He says, y'all are in the same church. You're saved by the same Lord. You've got the same God. You've got the same Lord. Open up to each other. Welcome each other. And he gives, if you want to keep reading, we don't have the time to look at it this morning, but if you kept reading on down into verses 8 through about verse 13, you know the example he uses of this that was in the church in the first century? He says, there were Jews and Gentiles, and yet what the spread of Christianity was all about is the Jews needing to accept the Gentiles because the Lord had called them into the fold. And so this is a great illustration of what it means for the strong to bear with the weak and to open up and to welcome them. And when we do that, it brings glory and honor to the Lord. So there you have it. 7-Up Christianity. If you consider yourself to be a strong Christian, this is what we need to be doing. And so I want to leave you with this challenge. It is your personal challenge this week. What I would like for each one of us to do is to commit right now to looking out and finding someone that needs our help. Looking right now to someone that we know is struggling. It could be emotionally, it could be physically, it could be spiritually. And to approach them not with an air of superiority, acting like you've got it all figured out, but just to approach them with care and concern. And just to say, brother or sister, I just wanted to check on you. You know, we've got some people that can't be here right now because of their concern for their health. And they're watching at home. We want to say hello to them today, and we're so thankful that they can tune in and they can worship with us right now. But maybe you know someone, and the reason they're not here is not because of their health concern. It's just because they have disengaged spiritually, and they have drawn back. Maybe they're just hurting. Maybe something's going on, and they're lonely, and they're struggling. And just like in the illustration we used before, when somebody's on your team and you're separated from them, your job is to go find them and to unite with them and then to survive together and win the battle. That's what we all want to do. We all want to win this battle that we call life. Good news is, the battle is victory if you're in the Lord. And so we want to encourage everyone today to remain in the Lord. If you're not in the Lord, you need to get into the Lord. You need to be baptized into Jesus through your faith and your willingness to repent, confess Him before men, and be in the Lord. Give your life to Him. There's a baptistry right back there, and we'd like nothing more than to use it today if somebody needs to be baptized and to start this journey with the Lord and with the church. If you've been baptized, though, and you're hurting, you're struggling, we've got a group of men here known as shepherds, and they watch for our souls, and they would love to talk with you, to counsel with you, to pray with you. Any of the ministers here would as well. Maybe you know someone real close here and you trust them and you look up to them. And just go to them. That's what we've talked about today, is being there, reaching out and helping and supporting those who need our help and our concern. A couple of our shepherds will be in the back as we sing this next song. And so if you have a spiritual need, we'd encourage you to walk back there and to talk with one of them. Thank you so much for being here today. Let's stand. Let's sing another song together.
Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me, all His wonderful passion and purity. May His Spirit divine all my being refine. Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me.
When somebody has been so unkind to you, some words spoken that pierces you through and through, think how we were begun, sat upon and revived. Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in you. From the dawn of the morning to close of day,
Good morning. It's so great to be here. We welcome each one of you that has been able to gather together today to worship. We're blessed to have a good number that are worshiping with us here in this building, a good number that are worshiping together with us online here in North Texas, across the states, and I believe one or two across the world. So it's just so great. We encourage each one of you to return each week to worship with us. Many of you have asked about making a special contribution for the benefit of those who were affected by the recent hurricane. As we've done in the past, we will be taking up a contribution from those that care to, and you can either mail a check to the church building, or you can place it in a container that's been placed out here at the sign-up counter right next to the door for the office. I think we can do that, and then we'll distribute that to a group in the area of the storm that can best disperse that to the ones that need it. I also want to remind you that the Mothers of Young Children class will begin virtually this Tuesday at 7 p.m., and you can look for that on the Waterview website. After the prayer, I do ask you if you would just remain seated and let the ushers help dismiss us by row from the back to front. And we do ask that you exit the building and try to find, I'll put a cool place, if I think it's cool, a dry place. Find a place, and let's visit, but we do ask that if you can get away from the building a little bit so we're not congregated completely too big there, and find a place to visit outside. And on behalf of the elders, I just want to say that we really thank you and appreciate you, your support and cooperation through these times that are difficult times that none of us knew how to prepare for, and we're still working through it, and we just pray that each one of you will continue to be strong and to support each other and look for ways to support each other. I know there's many groups that have just on their own formed, maybe with a little help, maybe not, have formed to support each other, and I just pray that you will continue to do that. We do have several among a number that are suffering from various ailments. Several in the hospital are recovering. I'll mention the brother of Danny Cummings has been released from the hospital after two successful surgeries, and he's going to have therapy starting very soon. Jane Farmer continues to struggle with her breathing issues, and we know Elaine Flynn has a rare medical condition, and she has found an organization which can help with the expense of the very expensive medication she's taking. Terry Herbst has been diagnosed with breast cancer. We want to continue little Ty Clackey, who's the little son of Wesley and Jennifer. He is planning to have surgery on September, and we pray that can happen and can continue to improve his health. Also, we want to continue to pray for Laura Alley, who's the daughter of Mike and Deborah Carter. We know that she's recovering from surgery for cancer, but she just now found out that she additionally will be having some more chemotherapy, at least six sessions of chemotherapy. So we ask that you continue to pray for her and all of her family. And it's good to hear that Brock Barton does not have a spinal cord leak, but we know the doctors were going to see him in September to continue on with his treatment. Our dear brother Gerald Hurley, not doing real well. He requires around-the-clock attention. I know several of you Waterview members have been helping Barbara while she looks for a more permanent situation to help with Gerald. And Diane Boone will have surgery this September 3rd at Plano Presby and be there for one night, I believe. We heard that Don Bushart will have an aortic valve replacement on Thursday at Medical City. And also just heard today that Karma Allison has been diagnosed with multiple myeloma. We ask that you pray and remember all those in hospice care. We especially think of Virginia Vaught, and we know there's many among us that are continuing ongoing struggles. Nancy Bradford, Jessica Heft, Lanny Little, Ann Scott, Bill Smith, John Childers, Ben and Diane Bill, and Jan Mowry, among others. We know there's many that have been in either hospital or facility, nursing home, and it's very difficult, if not impossible, for family to visit them. It's another situation we didn't prepare ourselves for, but we just pray for strength for all those in that situation. We extend our sympathy to the family of Marion Shivers, who passed away on Thursday, and her services were yesterday. Also, we have word that Stephen Moore's grandmother, June Moore, passed away on Saturday, and they had the graveside service Wednesday. Also, the nephew of Charles Gray was killed in a motorcycle accident on Monday. So please remember all these families. Pretty good list there of people among a number of others that are suffering from various health and life issues, and let's just continue to pray for all these. Let's now go to our Father in prayer. Our dear Father in heaven, as we come before you, we humbly bow before you. We praise you and we thank you for all the love and the care that you have for all of us, Lord. We pray, dear God, that we will always bring glory to your name in all the things we do. May we especially during these really difficult times remember to let our light shine brightly as Christians. God, please give us all the strength, the extra strength, every day to show patience and love and to seek out and recognize the opportunities that we can share our faith with others and we can shine our light. I ask God that you'll continue to be with the elders and ministers as we continue to shepherd and minister to this congregation. And Lord, please be with our country in this difficult time. There's a lot of unrest, and we pray that you'll bring peace to this country. We ask, O Lord, that you'll help each one of us to be patient and loving in our daily lives. We pray, God, that you'll bring an end to this pandemic very soon. Please bring wisdom to the medical teams, the leaders of our country, and many other people that are working to bring healing, comfort, and unity to our world. Lord, we pray that you will be with all of us as we make difficult decisions, decisions that we were not prepared to make. We pray that you will guide each of us as we decide about the things that impact our families, our lives, our jobs, our education system, and just about everything that we do each day. We especially pray that you will guide us as we work to maintain our Christian faith, as we daily walk the Christian walk, and as we work to influence the ones around us in a positive and Christian way. God, during this time, we know that many of us are not able to safely be around others. We don't have as many opportunities to support each other with our presence and fellowship. And we miss getting to see each other. And we many times struggle with the absence of being around others and being around those we love. We know this affects all of us, no matter what our age or situation is. And we pray, God, that you will give us all the strength to work through the trials of these times and help us to do our best to seek out ways to support and to encourage each other. Our dear God, there are many things that many among us are suffering with, many suffering through illnesses, some life situations, some recovering from surgery, several of our brothers and sisters that are suffering through ongoing struggles, many in facilities, hospice care. Please be with each one of them and their families. Bring them healing and comfort, O Lord. And dear God, we think now about those that have recently lost loved ones. Bring them strength and comfort and help each one of us to be able to show them support through their times of grieving. And God, we thank you for your love and care. We're so blessed that you have a plan, that you provide salvation, provide the opportunity for eternal salvation for each one of us. We pray, God, that in all things we do, we'll bring glory to your name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Have a good day.